Welcome to the Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast.
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 Welcome to the Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast with me, Dr. Janine Anderson. Heads up, this show may contain adult language and may mention specific foods. If you find either of those to be too triggering, I trust you to take care of yourself and do what you need to do. This podcast is sponsored by ED Care. ED Care has provided PHP, IOP, and outpatient treatment for all genders 18 and over since 2001. CAMHSA, which stands for Connection, Acceptance, Mindfulness, Sense of Self, and Action, is ED Care's mindfulness-based treatment approach and is incorporated into each individualized treatment plan. Facilities are located in Denver, Colorado Springs, and Kansas City, and all treatment is supported by master's-level clinicians or higher. ED Care offers four specialty tracks for binge eating disorder, elite athletes, substance use, and trauma. And the Connections House and affordable, supportive housing component adds an extra layer of supervised support. Visit eatingdisorder.care or call 866-771-0861. Hi, everyone. Welcome back to the podcast. Today, we're talking about the role of therapy and the therapeutic relationship in eating disorder recovery. We're joined by Catherine Cortese. Catherine Cortese, LCSW, ACSW, CEDS, has worked as a clinician in the eating disorders field since 1989. She has provided psychotherapy to individuals, families, and groups in inpatient and outpatient settings and in her own private practice, all specializing in the treatment of eating disorders. Kathy now serves as the president and editor-in-chief of Gurze Salucore Eating Disorders Resource Catalog. She is the host of the podcast series ED Matters and provides supervision to treatment professionals. Kathy has presented locally and nationally on various topics related to eating disorders and podcasting. Please help me welcome Kathy Cortese. Kathy, welcome. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for the invitation. How are you today?
I'm good. I'm excited to talk to you. Today, we're talking about the therapeutic relationship in eating disorder recovery. But before we take a deeper dive into that, tell the audience a little bit about yourself, about your work background. You have a bunch of cool things going on that we're going to talk about.
I do have a bunch of stuff going on.
You do, yeah.
Well, I guess I'll start with my intro into the world of eating disorders, which started back in 1989. I was a therapist intern on an eating disorders unit in a psych hospital. This was back in the day when people could seriously stay for 6 months or longer and insurance covered their stay. I then found myself working on the inpatient eating disorders unit in a regular hospital, and the medical director at the time was Ken Willis, and many people are familiar with Ken. He invited me to join him in his private practice, and then I opened my practice until I retired from the therapy end of things at the end of 2015. And my practice has concentrated on working with people with eating disorders. Moving along, back in 2013, Lee Cohn and Lindsay Hall, who commandeered the whole GERS experience, and because I go back a while, I'll acquaint people with them and their work. They started their catalog, they published books, they spoke, they provided the book inventory at different conferences. Anyway, they were amazing people who brought a good amount of excellent attention to what I would say was a nascent issue in certainly the U.S. They termed, and thank you so much, Lee and Lindsay, that the catalog itself is the most widely used resource in the eating disorders field since 1980. And in addition to the catalog, like I said, they had a bunch of other stuff. They decided to do some retirement in 2013, and I had always received their catalog as a therapist and was grateful for the information. At that time, the catalog primarily offered the GERS books and treatment facilities that I wouldn't have known about because they were throughout the country. When they made their announcement about stepping down, no one was seeming to step up. So I considered this too much of a valuable resource for the field. And so I approached my son, Michael. He has tech business sense, and said, what do you think? And he was like, yeah, let's find out. So we went out to California and we started with our first print edition in 2014. Had to change the name a little bit just because. So we're technically Gurze Salucore, although people call us Gurze, which is actually very complimentary. The Salucore, that was our little brains, Salu for wellness, core, the body. And what happens is he just pitches me the next good idea to provide for the eating disorders community. And as of today, we have the annual print catalog, which also includes, in addition to books and treatment facilities, book excerpts, articles from leaders in the field. Catalog is digitally interactive from the website. We have our website, ED catalog, spelled edcatalogue.com. We offer a free monthly e-newsletter, which generally contains three articles and a book interview. We have our weekly podcasts called ED Matters. There's ED Pulse, which is a subscription service. He has three Facebook groups, one for individuals, one for family and friends and loved ones, one for professionals, and we do consulting work for people in private practices.
So like I said, lots of things.
Well, he's young and energetic, and I stick with the content, and he takes care of all those other things that I consider headaches. So,
right. Lovely. Well, I guess I want to just kind of recap real quickly for listeners who aren't familiar with Gurze and now Gurze Salucore. That resource is a catalog of eating disorder books, lists of treatment centers, and now a bunch more articles and book excerpts, like you mentioned, all located in one place. And the resources in there are high quality. So if something is made it into that catalog, it's reputable. And so I know sometimes when folks out there are looking for resources online or you're searching on Amazon and whatnot, it's kind of hard to tell if something is legitimate and should be trusted versus maybe it's not something you should be reading. And looking things up in the catalog is a really great way to filter through all of that. Just wanted to say that for people who aren't familiar with that resource or people who are newer to listening. And of course, I will link to your podcast, the catalog, your website, everything in the show notes as usual. There's a ton of stuff on your website. It's a wealth of really good information. Your podcast has the most amazing people in the field on. So I would definitely say go through and check out those episodes as well for people. So aside from your long career doing lots of really awesome things, we're mostly talking about therapy today because you have a lot of experience as a therapist who's worked with eating disorders for so many years. Tell me a little bit about some of the things that you've noticed doing therapy with people who are trying to recover from eating disorders.
My pleasure. I also would just like to say thank you for all those kind words that you just shared about our work. We are grateful to the community for their generous spirit in contributing to what we can do and bring. So, well, I chose the field of eating disorder recovery because of its complexities. I find the work challenging and stimulating, and my experience as a therapist has been enriched by the wonderful people, beautiful people, sincere people that I've gotten to know through my work with them. When you are a therapist, you have to have your knowledge base. You have to know every emotion that humanity experiences, the ones that you have as well, and a lot of personal awarenesses. So I typically relied on a number of skills that I would incorporate, but I do feel I was very relational in my work with my people with eating disorders. I think there's so much that can be gained from that in regular therapy, we'll call it, but also in working with people who have eating disorders. There's certainly lots of literature out there now about the concerns of the many disconnects that people with eating disorders experience, connects from their body, from relationships, from their what I consider true self, sitting in the room together. In my opinion, I'm going to say not just a privilege, but something I think I have a lot of reverence for because of that thing that people bring, and that is their essence. It's not objective, you know, it's amorphous. It's something you can't touch, yet you know it. So sharing that space, caring, being non-judgmental, and all of this stuff is, again, appropriate for therapy. But I think without this, I don't think you can really do eating disorders work, accepting, appreciating this person who is sometimes willing and sometimes less willing to share themselves with you. And, you know, I know you've sat and had the privilege yourself to ask someone to share that and to get to know that self or help form that self, because with eating disorders, people either have lost perhaps a sense of their true self or maybe haven't had a chance to develop it yet.
Yes, I wholeheartedly agree. And especially the part about recognizing how much of an honor it is to do the work that we do, even when the work is challenging. And when it's challenging for us as a therapist, it's definitely more challenging for the client. So we're saying that with so much respect to you all. Tell us a little bit about what you think makes a good therapeutic alliance.
I think caring.
Yeah.
Caring, concern, being authentic yourself, you know, being yourself. And I can tell you one really awesome compliment I got from one of my younger people. I loved it. She had been to a number of different therapies over the years, and we were sitting together, and she had a great sense of humor. So she was talking about this one therapist that she told me she called the turtle. And I said, well, why did you call her the turtle? And she said, well, she would sit in her chair, and every once in a while she'd pop her head out, and then she'd sort of pull back, and then she'd pop out again and pull back. So I said, okay, well, what do you call me? Not knowing. And she said, you're real. And I was like, oh my God. Oh my God. That was so, just such a wonderful moment for me to hear. That was her experience of us in the room. So I think that contributes to the relationship, being patient, acknowledging your own blunders, apologizing. There's so much that goes into making that kind of relationship such that people can trust you.
Yeah, definitely. I want to talk about two parts that I'm thinking of right now, and jump in and let me know what you're thinking about too. You know, one is that it can be very difficult when you're the client to develop trust for your therapist just in general. But then the second part, when we add that piece of there's an eating disorder in the mix too, I think the eating disorder interferes with therapy in its own unique ways, or at least shows up in the room in ways that can be challenging in therapy. So tell us a little bit about how people can build trust with their therapist and how you think the eating disorder kind of interjects in there sometimes too.
I think, again, it's like a feeling, you know, you get the feeling that it's okay. And I think one of the things we all recognize that some people come in reluctantly or not wishing to be there at all. We appreciate that. We can, in a conversation, convey understanding, ask with, you know, that just sense of curiosity, non-judgmental curiosity, you know, what's happening for you now? How do you feel about this? How weird is this? I try to interject humor and engage the individual. And, you know, I'm an LCSW, so we learned this like the first week in our graduate school, meet the client where they are. So I think that little by little, recognizing that some people maybe haven't trusted anybody, and I mean anybody, throughout their life. They've come to you with experiences of rejection and judgment, trauma, secrets, shame, guilt, betrayal. You know, there's so many things that people walk into a room with. They walk around their world with it. And I think we have to be very considerate, understanding. I was very big on validation. And I mean that in a couple of ways, validating their real experience, but also validating, and this is where, you know, the eating disorder recovery piece is too. Anything that I saw, I heard was steps toward health, I would comment on and give them, like, underscore it and remark about how positive it was. Not like in a gushy way, but in a way that I think people could connect to. Because I think sometimes people with eating disorders have a hard time knowing, oh, that was good, what I just did. Oh, I did that next thing, and that was good too. So to have somebody acknowledge those steps and really sit with that, and that kind of connection helps for trust too, and just noticing any shifts, because there's always shifts going on in the room, and gently, kindly, or humorously bringing attention to them.
That's my preferred method, is humor. What are some common things that you notice that in your years of work with clients who have eating disorders in therapy that you wind up working on or talking about in eating disorder recovery, maybe some of the core themes?
Well, one thing that comes to mind is the idea of having a need and knowing that need is worthy, valuable, and it has to go to the self as well, that anything that's connected like a need is part of the self. So allowing those needs to be present for the individual to develop the strength to voice those needs and then to charge on out there out of your room at some point in time and use their voice to acknowledge their needs to themselves and others, I think is something that is essential when you're working with people with eating disorders. Another thing I would always do, and they'd be like, oh, really, you're doing it again. I would ask people to sit with it. You know, there's the clients have developed a curiosity. They're noticing their behaviors, thoughts, and feelings. Let's not rush. You know, let's sit with that feeling state. You know, tell me about it.
Yeah, I can feel all of my clients who listen to this podcast, all of their collective eyes rolling at this point because it's such a difficult practice at first when you're doing it, but it's also so important and relaxing that judgment muscle that I think everybody works out way too much and just being in the moment. But continue talking to us about that, just how you need to learn to sit with things too.
Yeah, sitting with it so that it becomes available because there's lots of layers that these things might hide under. So the access allows for communication and more appreciation. And I have seen many times over that I even coined this fun little phrase, triumph of the human spirit, when you sit with someone with their aha, because they've allowed themselves to go deeper and to sit with it, and then to have a recognition that helps them move forward. You know, another thing that I think we strive for is to sit with our clients when they have their feelings, when they're really feeling their feelings. We want that. We want the anger. We want the desperation. We want that torture. We want the fear to be present and sometimes be directed at us. And I think it's important for us to be with it, to be with that, to let it be heard for the client, you know, with the eating disorder to find out, I'm not banishing you. Actually, I want to hear more about it. I want to hear, you know, I want to hear it and hear it and hear it. And it's okay. And there's no rupture in our relationship. You get to curse me out. You can pick up something and throw it. Yeah, it's all right. You know, and find out that the client's anger is tolerable, is something to learn from, et cetera, et cetera. Hopefully that makes sense.
Right, that those things that are normally unwelcome sometimes in the person's life with other people that they know or within themselves that are unwelcome, like the emotion of anger, when they're welcome in therapy, that that can be corrective and healing for people, for sure.
Mm-hmm. And corrective in that, I think, you know, that fear of going there, I'm going to go too far. You know, eating disorder clients are so tuned into other people's feelings and concerns and, you know, quote unquote, mine don't matter as much. And to find out that that's not true, that their feelings and concerns matter, and you can still connect to the person and still have a good relationship with them.
Absolutely. Tell us a little bit about why you think eating disorders tend to squash people's needs and emotions.
Well, I consider an eating disorder like it lets you live in the margin. So if you think back to grammar school, you know, and your loose leaf paper, and you know that little margin over there on the left on the other side of the right line, that's pretty much all the eating disorder is going to let you do. The eating disorder wants to take up that whole other space, control you. If you have a little sort of teeny weeny note that you want to put in the margin, go right ahead. But you've got, you know, that eating disorder voice, it's relentless. It doesn't want to lose its grip. It wants you, and it's nasty. Nasty is being nice. So then to have a need other than to adhere to the demands of the eating disorder, no room for yourself, no room for you, no room for relationship, no room. And I think if you picture that loose leaf paper, you get a sense of how little room you got.
I think that that's a great visual to go along with a lot of how people experience things, and that you just have so little space, and really the eating disorder becomes the center of what people think and feel about all the time. And it's very difficult and exhausting. And then the work in therapy is creating more space for who you actually are, not just this eating disorder that's there.
Oh, and then, you know, let's just throw shame in, because EGAD, you know, so now we've got that whole piece that's always part of the eating disorder experience.
Tell us more about what you've noticed from your clinical experience with shame and eating disorders and how that comes up for people.
You know, the shame is that I am bad. I am deficient. I am inadequate. I am no good. And I would be surprised if someone who's in the midst of an eating disorder doesn't feel that type of self-disgust and self-loathing. And for people who don't know that sort of inside ugliness, you know, that the eating disorder imposes on an individual, it's pure torture for the person to walk around like that. You know, these people are like so phenomenally high functioning, and yet we know that's what's going on for them. So, you know, helping the person become who they really are and helping them understand that, you know, there's lots of ways we can counter that shame, and you just do it little by little.
Right.
Recognizing when it shows up, because I think that's the other thing. I don't necessarily think people actually recognize shame when it's there. And we have to educate them that shame talking, that's what that is. And let's challenge it. What's true? What's not true about that?
What do you think sets people up for feeling so much shame when they have an eating disorder?
Oof. Okay. Well, you know, the overvaluation stuff of body size and shape. And with eating disorders, you know, we know brain research is helping us understand lots about the distortions that people experience. We've got lots of societal influences to help, let's just say, magnify and comparisons galore. Yeah, social media can be pretty harsh. And I think that it comes from the inside and the outside.
Right. Absolutely. And it's so important to address that in therapy, and also to have a relationship with your therapist where you feel like you're able to talk about shame and that it's a topic that is continually getting worked through. One of our past guests on the podcast said, shame is Miracle-Grow for eating disorders. And it just really makes the eating disorder take off. I'm wondering, in our kind of last kind of minutes together here, what would you say to somebody who is trying to recover from their eating disorder right now, and they're just really having a tough time in therapy itself?
You know what? I'd say talk about it. I'd say go to your therapist and say, I am having the hardest time right now. This, and whatever it is, you know, I think this whole process stinks. I would say just talk, because there's something to be gained by having that conversation. I can't tell you what it is, but you and your therapist will come to know it. And you have to believe that if that kind of thing is going on or something like that, bring it into the room, talk about it, find the words, and you'll find your way out.
Yeah. I also think it's really important that if you're working with a therapist and you're feeling something funny in the relationship, you don't feel as connected as you want to, if there's anything going on there, that you bring it up with your therapist and you're able to talk about that explicitly. I think in some cases, maybe it's not a good fit or it can't be worked through for whatever reason. And in those cases, then you think about, maybe I need to find someone else, but definitely bring those things up as well.
Yeah, I so agree with you, because that's how you find out, typically. You know, that's one way you're going to find out, is this really going to work for me? You know, are you the shoes that fit on my foot so nicely, or do I need to go shopping? And that's okay. But if you're on your third therapist in 6 weeks, yeah, you might want to think further.
Right. Think about what's going on.
Yeah. Like, do I really, you know, what's going on? Yeah. Oh, and let us not forget to mention the fear of recovery. Because if that doesn't come up in the conversation, or ambivalence about recovery, then, you know, we're not really getting our work done here.
Yeah, that can get in the way for sure, too. What words of hope do you have for people as we wrap up?
That you can't see me, but I'm smiling because I have faces of many people who have come through my life, brought me great stuff, and they are recovered and they are living the truthful lives. And I know you think this is yada, 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 but I see them in my head right now. I see their smiles. I see how alive they are, and I see their contributions that they bring, whether it's to their intimate circle or the greater world. Those people are walking around, and if they could do it, you could do it.
Kathy Cortese, couldn't put it better myself. Thank you so much for joining us today and sharing your clinical wisdom. Again, everybody, I'm going to link to all of Kathy's materials, websites, all that stuff. Please go check out ED Catalog and their website. There's so much on there. The podcast is awesome. Like everything you could ever want to know about eating disorders, this is a really, really great place to start. If you can't find it on there, I don't know really where you're going to find it. So Kathy, again, thank you so much for joining me. I will link everything down below. Thanks for being a part of the episode.
Thank you so much for your time. Janine, you are a delightful interviewer. Thank you.
Thanks for joining me for another episode. Let's keep in touch. You can find all the information you need about the podcast at eatingdisorderrecoverypodcast.com, including full podcast episodes and links to all of our social media sites. You can join our Facebook group for the podcast by searching Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast on Facebook. This is a closed group for listeners of the podcast looking to connect, share resources, and get involved in a pro-recovery community. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, or YouTube. Please leave us a review and let us know how we're doing. Talk to you next time on the Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast.